Namaskar. Hello, viewers. Welcome to another episode of Cultural Journey with Manoshi, Sanskritik Safar Manoshi ke saath mein. Aaj hum atyant bhagyashali hain ki studio mein hamare aaj maujood hain vishwavikhyat surbahar va sitar vadak imdad khani gharana se sambandh rakhne wale Padma Bhushan Pandit Budhaditya Mukherjee. It's an honor for us to have the world-renowned sitarist and surbahar player, Pandit Budhaditya Mukherjee, in our studios. Panditji is known for his unique style of playing sitar, which includes an unmatchable speed and clarity with the khayal gayaki ang. Aiye, Pandit Budhaditya Mukherjee se baatcheet karte hain aur unke safar par chalte hain. Namaskar, Panditji. What an honor for us to have you in our studios. Thank you so much for coming.
It's my honor, pleasure, and I'm so elated to be on this fantastic show.
Thank you. Our first question would be, our viewers would like to know, how did this journey of yours, how did this musical journey of yours begin, and how did you get introduced to sitar?
Well, I was blessed to be born to Bimbulindu Mukherjee and Nilima Mukherjee, my father and mother.
Right.
And my father was a well-known sitar player, mm-hmm. and has been my guru. Mm-hmm. So I was very lucky to have my guru at home in my father, and all my training has been from him.
Mm-hmm. This was our home in Bhilai, Pratibha, named after my grandmother, our abode of peace, harmony and music for over 26 years. Not only an enlightened artist on many instruments other than his first love sitar, my father was adept in carrying out maintenance of all the instruments he had. Right from my early years, he imparted to me his knowledge on vital maintenance issues of the instruments, more specifically the sitar and surbahar. This was vitally necessary in Bhilai as there was no external facility for the same there. Some of his favorite instruments were surbahar, dilruba, sur singar, sarod, and one of the rarest instruments he had was the babili veena, a rare veena played by Karnataka artists carved out of a single piece of wood. All these instruments are now with me. He often designed his own instruments too. This is his self-conceived and designed sursingar. This is his self-conceived Aditya veena, named after his son Budhaditya. This is his self-conceived Bijaya veena, named after his grandson Bijayaditya. Whichever be the instrument, he handled them with equal ease and great proficiency and had many students learning a variety of these instruments from him apart from sitar. It was amazing what he did with the sarangi, one of the rarest Indian instruments today. So much of the gayaki concepts of our classical music he actually played on the sarangi so that I could follow and try to imbibe it on sitar. This was his ek tantri veena, a single stringed instrument. The sitar remained, of course, his first love. While his self-designed sursingar was amongst his first innovations, the first surbahar that came into our family was one of late Ustad Inayat Khan's, which had remained with the sitar maker late Shri Makhanlal Roy of Bhavanipur, Kolkata. This is Surbeen, one more of his self-designed instruments based on a swarmandal. Whether as the general manager over mines and quarries of Bhilai Steel Plant, or as the Vice Chancellor of Indira Kala Sangeet Vishwavidyalaya Khairagarh, his door was universally open to anyone who wanted to learn from him, and it was totally free of charge. My mother Nilima took care of us with the greatest of compassion. With complete and selfless dedication to my father's musical passion, she took great care and looked after the students who came, stayed freely and often indefinitely at our home while learning. Thus passed in happiness the days of Bimalendu and Nilima together. My mother's ever supportive ambience helped not only us but all the students flourish in their work. My mother made beautiful alpunas, intricate designs specially meant for the pujas. Saraswati Puja was a very important occasion in our house, and each and every instrument was considered a representative of Goddess Saraswati. They were displayed along with the goddess, especially during the day of the puja, along with all books which were also revered and displayed parallelly. My son Vijayaditya too started his lessons in sitar from his grandfather at the age of 5, just as I also had started my lessons from my father at the age of 5.
When I was very young, I was perhaps 5 years of age, that time my father brought me a small sitar. Something that a 5-year-old can hold. The okay. Full-size sitar is a larger thing, and a 5-year-old cannot hold it.
Right.
So, and he said that this is the, you have to play this. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you cannot expect a 5-year-old child to start with sa, re, ga, ma, all technicalities, this and that. It's like, it should be like a toy for the child.
Right.
And my father was very wise in his visions how to teach. So with me, he gave me a small composition. Mm-hmm. He told me that, okay, these are some important points, say a sa and a pa and a sa. Mm-hmm. So, and he made me realize that these notes are played by pressing these frets, mm-hmm. which is a very small thing. And then instead of telling me to practice sa re ga ma pa dha ni sa and all mm-hmm. that, the typical exercises, mm-hmm. he gave me a small composition, mm-hmm. and he said, you play this. It sounded nice. I tried to play it, mm-hmm. and then because I liked, and he made sure that he, whatever he gave me, it spiraled into a situation of pleasure, a desire to take and play on the sitar another day and another day and another day, because that is important. If the child gets bored with the instrument or the music that is being expected, then he will not want to play.
Right.
So on this, my father's foresight, I am the result of that.
Amazing, what a guru.
Yes, what can I say?
Right.
It is because of his foresight and his compassion and the liberties he allowed me mm-hmm. in my getting to like the music mm-hmm. and play the sitar more effectively is something that I have no words to express it with.
Of course.
Except the music that I am playing, I owe it to him.
Oh, nice. However, you are a metallurgical engineer, and what made you take sitar as your, well, I wouldn't say career as such, but yes, career. What made you go towards sitar, and was it really difficult?
Today, I am known as a sitar player.
Right.
I have been a professional sitar player from almost the age of 16.
Right.
But this is a very fragile situation of decision making at a time of life mm-hmm. when the future has a lot yet to show you.
Mm-hmm.
Because I did my studies in school, then when I went to, after I did school, all the time I was playing sitar.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, in 1970, in the radio music competition, I was in class 10. And I topped the radio music competition while I was in school itself.
Right.
All that was a kind of, it didn't at that time show the path that what profession I would take. And a musician's profession is fragile. One cannot say, look, I am going to become a musician and lo, you become a musician. It doesn't happen like that. So, a backup was required.
Okay.
And I came from a family in which education was a commonplace thought. So, I also needed to learn, study something. And we used to live in a place called Bhilai. It's more well known for a steel plant.
Right.
And so, kind of obvious choice for me was to learn something in which if I became an engineer, I could work in a steel plant if needed. But these were all preparation points,
right,
not decision making points.
Right.
And the engineering study was a backup situation. So, I was beginning to like sitar more and more. And happily, I found that in those young, at that young age, whatever little sitar I might have been playing seemed to get an acceptance from elders and many people who used to hold concerts. And I without really realizing when, one day I realized that I was actually playing on the stage in front of many people at various places.
Right.
But that still does not say that this is going to last. Who knows?
Right.
Future is never known.
Mm-hmm.
So we did. So I continued with my studies, and by the grace of Almighty, from first year, I used to top the engineering faculties.
Mm-hmm.
It was a common faculty. Our system of education made the first 2 years in engineering as a common faculty, and then from the third year, we used to go into the fields that mm-hmm. we were expected. So, my professors were very kind, they allowed me the liberty. In engineering, you know that you have to have attendance, very strict attendance schedule, and well, it is known to everybody who does engineering.
Right.
And I was moving here and there
mm-hmm.
for concerts
mm-hmm.
and my professors had, I would say, a very kind and soft corner for me,
mm-hmm.
for I was able to bring forward my institute's name also at the various venues that I went.
Yeah.
So, they allowed me the liberty of moving and playing. So, that was a huge gift,
mm-hmm.
I would say a gift, mm-hmm. a precious gift of belief that I received from my professors in the engineering course, that they said, okay, we'll give you the liberty, but you have to allow, your academic work has to remain where you have already placed it. So, if I flopped in that, all these liberties would be taken away. So, you can see that it was quite a challenging situation where I was allowed a liberty of going and performing
mm-hmm.
wherever and whenever I wanted. But at the same time, that liberty depended on my ability to maintain
mm-hmm.
myself at the highest academic output point.
Right.
So, it also taught me
mm-hmm.
serious self-discipline, and it also helped me realize the importance of time management.
All that you are saying are so precious, like every word is a gem, and it teaches everybody a lot of things that you are saying from your experience, what you had. Thank you so much. Your sitar is very, very famous for one reason. I know that it's a unique sitar because you created it. You actually, I have read in other places that this sitar is after a lot of experiments that you did with other sitars, you actually made this sitar. Aap is sitar ke baare mein hame zara bataiye ki kya wajah thi ki aapko ye sitar aakhir mein jaake आपने बनाया और मिला आपको?
देखिए, सितार वादन करने के लिए जो साज मिलता है, द इंस्ट्रूमेंट दैट वी टच हैज़ टू हैव एन एम्बिएंट साउंड विच इंस्पायर्स द आर्टिस्ट टू बी मोर क्रिएटिव. नाउ आई इन माय इमेजिनेशन आई हैव सम म्यूजिक वर्किंग. दिस इज अ क्रिएटिव म्यूजिक, सो आई हैव लर्न समथिंग एंड आई एम ट्राइंग टू लिव विद इट. हाउ डू आई लिव विद इट? I try to express it through the instrument that I am holding and touching. Now, in my desire to express myself, I need the support of a particular type of sound. Okay. Just having an instrument that looks like this, known as the sitar, please mark my words. Having an instrument that looks like this, there are thousands and thousands of sitars made and they look the same, doesn't exactly sound the same, or the same, my statement is incorrect, it does not sound, give the sound of that ambient sound that I individually want for my music to survive. When I need myself to survive through the music, I have but one support, and that is the ambient sound of the sitar, which I am not getting. So it stifles the creativity of an artist. Many people who might have experienced this will agree with me when they hear that I too felt the similar stifling situation handling almost 9 sitars over a period of 22 years of my youth. So
how did this sitar finally?
So, but you can understand that in those 22 years, maybe 23 years, I was playing the sitar with a sound that did not support my desires.
Right.
So you can imagine the extreme strained mental condition that I might have been experiencing, which of course I did not allow it to be understood by anybody. But every instant was an extreme strain. So one day I decided, and you can just understand that what I want as the sound is almost next to impossible to explain that to another person. Suppose I am asking somebody to make a sitar with the sound of my imagination, how on earth am I going to explain my imagination to that person? It's like this, it's like that, it's like this, it carries no meaning. So that, as you can easily gauge, left me with just one choice. Make your sound.
Make it yourself.
And I knew nothing about the structural work of the sitar. I was a sitar player, not a sitar constructor. So as a result, I had to take this challenge of ripping apart sitars, working or creating a working process. Creating a working process requires immense research. And sitar, as you see, is a sealed instrument. And if you have to work on fine structural changes in the inside, which is creating different frequency outputs, so you don't know which combination is going to give you that sound. So you have to rip apart the sitar, work a bit on that, reseal it, play it, wait for the whole thing to dry, play it, check the sound, is it towards the direction that you want or not. But thankfully, at least I know that what I want. That was like a small tiny lamp giving a glow in total darkness, showing me that path of where I need to reach, with no way to know how to reach.
Wow.
I'm sure you can understand
so
the situation.
It's like a discovery that you made, right, on your path.
Discovery would be if I did not know where that light is.
Okay.
So I would not exactly say it was a discovery, because that light, the image of the sound I wanted, was embedded in my mind. But I did not have any process. So to create the process, I had to obviously rip apart the sound,
rip apart the instrument.
I obviously had to rip apart the sitar hundreds of times, and then ripping apart the sitar repeatedly could easily also end up damaging the sitar. And these processes are all one-way processes. If you have thinned out, if you have overdone a particular work, you just can't go back. So you have to discard the thing. You restart the whole process, remembering your error.
Right.
So like that, I spent almost 12 years, perhaps 13 years. Sitar might have been opened, say, twice, might have been opened 10 times. I don't remember any longer. I do not wish to remember. But the net result is, with that, slowly, I found the direction to move, and I reached this sitar's, the sound which I have now. And I would like to explain the change in my survival conditions with the sitar with one statement. Earlier, I had to play the sitar, which was, I had to play the sitar. After this sound got created in this sitar, the sitar now plays me.
How beautiful.
So, you can understand how comfortable I am with this sound. And I have been often asked, who makes your sitar? Who has made your sitar? So, when I say that I have designed, I make the sitar. I would only say that I make the sound.
The sound that you want.
And to make the sound is quite a complex process. Not quite a complex process, it is an incredibly complex process.
I'm not sure if your metallurgical engineering background helped you a little bit in making the sitar. Something to do with
I would
strength?
Not say so much, because it helped me in a different way. It helped me to, because of the nature of engineering studies, which requires a very discerning and highly focused mind. So the creation of state of mind, my engineering studies helped me in that way. The state of mind, I could focus to read my necessities accurately, and also read the inaccuracies over these 12 years of my work, so that I could relate how far am I from what I want. If I was out of focus in that, then I would never reach where I have reached.
Now that with that immense knowledge that you have, do you also teach? Do you have a gurukul, or do you have an institution where you teach students?
After seeing, my father had almost 400 students over the years that I saw him teach. I saw various situations and realized that in spite of the apar kindness, incredible kindness that my father bestowed upon all the students who just walked in at any time of the day or night, and he obliged everybody, that sometimes people did not realize the value of the most expensive gift of teaching that a saint is selflessly giving them. I consider my father's thought process saintly. He gave more time to all his students than I got from him. And to him, all his students were the same. But then every individual is different. So the outputs obviously were different. I am also a student. My output is there for you to see. So I realized that this is not exactly how people would take the serious nature of the music. So I have been very selective, extremely selective, because someone who says that he has learned from me, anybody knowing that whatever sitar I play, would expect that person to be able to deliver a level of music which is giving some credence to the fact that he says he has learned from me.
Exactly. Sure.
Now suppose that doesn't happen. and the person's output is so poor, having come in contact with me, and he takes my name and his output remains so poor, I would be questioned, not he. Am I a bad teacher? Perhaps I do not know how to teach. No one will blame the student. The teacher will be questioned, is this how you teach?
Right.
So that is important, that for me is an important consideration. So I have now, could say, 4 students.
Okay.
But I am happy to be able to say that they, whatever sitar they play, I would be able to sit for a while and listen to them.
That's very nice. Yeah, that's great. Yeah. आजकल हम ऑनलाइन टीचिंग के बारे में बहुत बात करते हैं.
मैंने भी सुना है.
हाँ, और ये ऑनलाइन टीचिंग, आप, what are your views? आपको क्या लगता है कि ये होना चाहिए, नहीं होना चाहिए?
Online is a convenience.
अच्छा.
Somebody who is staying in perhaps thousands of kilometers away from where their teacher stays, internet has made it possible for a communication to occur. But of course, the qualities of that communication leave much to be desired. Across continents, one doesn't know how things are going to, how the communication will be. However, what I understand from this incredible progress in technology, it still does not, has not, I am speaking specifically for my little bit of experience. It could be a totally different thing with somebody else's experience. But in my experience, while teaching the sitar, it is not just you press the string to the frets and you stroke with the right hand and you press this and you give a sound over here and that's sitar playing. Well, that's basic sitar playing, yes, of course. But it doesn't make much music. Now, to communicate intricacies of expression, if a person-to-person communication, a one-to-one communication does not occur, then it leaves certain doubts in the person who is receiving the communication and could be interpreted incorrectly, because the aesthetics don't get fully conveyed through this wonderfully digitized medium.
That's right, yes. About your style, you have a unique style of playing. It includes that the clarity, the speed that we talk about all the time, and as well as it has that khayal gayaki ang included. So how do you maintain that balance, and how do you do it? If you can please share that with our viewers, the technical part of it, that would be really nice.
It's creative music.
Right.
Upaj is how we try to move in the music. We have the rag. The rag has fixed boundary. But in the boundary, there are huge dimensions that you can move, that you can move towards. So basically, the mind is singing. Everybody's mind, whether whatever instrument they play, a bowing instrument, the voice is also an instrument,
of course.
A stroke stringed instrument like the sitar or the sarod, surbhar, veena, whatever you play, the mind is singing. The hands are a reflection of what the mind is singing. So the gayaki ang means the mind is actually singing out a khayal or whatever.
Right.
Our mind is desiring the music to be expressed in that way. But I am not singing. So I am playing the sitar. So my movement in music, my imagination will get manifested through the instrument that I am playing. This is the physical manifestation of the imagination that is working. The imagination is the gayaki ang. I will explain why this manifestation is complicated. Because when we are specially playing the alap, let me, because alap is the most complex part and it's the most beautiful part of the gayaki ang. So when we are playing the alap, we are expected to deliver the music in a flowing and very curvaceous phrases. Mm-hmm. Now, those beautiful phrases need a certain time length for its complete, for its completion. Mm-hmm. The sitar sound may not necessarily support that length of duration of that musical phrase.
Okay.
So obviously you are expected that, well, how do you keep the phrase going? You strike again.
Mm-hmm.
But if the strike of that point is not at the most desirable part,
mm-hmm.
the source of your sound, your stroke,
mm-hmm.
the source, your sound creation will be the death of the phrase. So your music is finished only because you needed to refurbish the sound with a stroke.
Right.
And it didn't happen at the right point.
Right.
So this understanding is what makes alap so difficult on the sitar.
Mm-hmm.
And so easily one tends to find mm-hmm. that the alap has become not so attractive.
Mm-hmm.
Though that is the most attractive part of the music. So in gayaki ang, to be able to present the flow of music the way a vocalist would sing,
mm-hmm.
I'm limiting myself to the khyalang.
Mm-hmm.
So, following that path is what makes us say, at least it makes me say, that my music follows the gayaki ang.
Right.
It follows the gayaki ang.
Right. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Panditji, another question. With the reality shows and all that, people want to really get fame mm-hmm. very quickly. So what do you think is the prospect of Indian classical music as such? What are your views?
This is a very interesting question. First of all, we are looking for fame. So fame is the purpose, not the music necessarily.
Many a times, yeah.
We have been taught to understand the music is the purpose, the fame
right.
follows.
Right.
And your music has to be so consistently good
mm-hmm.
that it will cause the people to like your music
mm-hmm.
and that kind of fame
mm-hmm.
is perhaps a little bit more desired for, something that lasts. In our classical music, we move within the music in an extempore way. So the person playing the music is the instantaneous
creation, right?
Creator.
There. Right.
So the person who is creating the music is instantly also making the manifestation of that creation
mm-hmm.
available through the instrument that he or she is playing.
Mm-hmm.
So this upaj, this creative, for a person to be creative,
mm-hmm.
it's actually not that easy a process.
Mm-hmm.
You learn from your guru, who is a much more experienced person in this process.
Mm-hmm.
And he gives you a pathway.
Mm-hmm.
After that is input. Then there is assimilation of the input.
Mm-hmm.
Assimilation takes a long time because it is somebody's way of thinking which you are allowing to flow into your way of thinking, and then you accept it, try to live with it and try to experience the beauty of the other person's thinking, so much so that you start thinking the music's pathway in the same way. This is easier said than done. This is why in Indian classical music,
mm-hmm.
your association with the guru is, if the teacher gives this much material to you,
mm-hmm.
you are expected to create, recreate
mm-hmm.
and make it grow
mm-hmm.
so that this with your thought process becomes so much. That is the assimilative part. And this could take a person an unknown length of time.
That's right.
It could be for a person who is very passionate, a shorter length of time. A person who needs to become passionate, a longer length of time.
However, there are no shortcuts, of course.
I have yet to find out a shortcut because in my limited intellect, I have had to spend almost 59 years with the sitar.
59 years.
I started when I was mm-hmm. 5 and mm-hmm. 64. So, 59 mm-hmm. years with the sitar. And at 64, I can happily say that I am still learning.
Beautiful.
So, what am I learning at this moment? Whatever music I play, any time I play, there is a self-assessment going on. That's my father is no longer with us. That is my misfortune. But his memories and ways of teaching are there in my mind. And I apply my own music. Imagine that my teacher is improving, is helping me improve that. Certainly, I am still improving. I shall be improving as long as I will be playing the sitar. But if we are expecting a shortcut, then I am sorry, I don't have anything to tell my viewers.
Panditji, we would really like to know about your family. Who is in your family and a little bit about that.
Well, my father, my guru, late Pandit Budhaditya Mukherjee, is a source of my inspiration, my teacher. His compassionate teaching has helped me, not helped me, he has made me live with the sitar as I have learned to live with the sitar. My mother, Srimati Nilima Mukherjee, mm-hmm. she was a child is always running out to play. And one day I was also a very young person starting the sitar at 5, 6, 7, whatever. So who is going to make the boy practice? My father was a senior, very senior officer in the Bhilai steel plant. Mm-hmm. He had 19,000 people working under him. Mm-hmm. He had huge responsibilities. So in the morning, half an hour little time I was to get. And then in the evening, I was supposed to, when he came home, I was supposed to play for 15, 20 minutes, half an hour, little bit, whatever music. Mm-hmm. And whatever he has taught me in the morning, a response to that, I had to give in the evening. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. at least I should have that much of capability to make him remain sitting there wanting to listen to me. So that was my daily test. That my father and mother. Then I am blessed to be married to Navneeta, now 38 years. Navneeta is an incredible phenomenon in my life.
Wow.
Incredible, because she helped me realize more about myself than I knew. And I have no ways to adequately put her contribution, her incredible and positive contribution in my life, for me to have led this lonely journey with the sitar so happily. The journey with the sitar is extremely lonely. Mm-hmm. There is no one to
explain that a little bit. Our viewers would like to know.
There was no one to look towards except your own music. There are other great ones who have played good, fantastic sitar. Mm-hmm. They are there at a pedestal, mm-hmm. on the pedestal level. Mm-hmm. Where are you? Mm-hmm. And when you see the difference occurring from where sitar has already been played, and you want to reach there, and you find yourself at a very, very low level, and that is kind of the gradient that tries to pull you up, and it's a journey where your self-assessment, this is why it is lonely. You are the only person who can make that assessment most accurately.
You have put this so beautifully in the analysis. I'm amazed. Yeah.
And if 1,000 opinions come to you, mm-hmm. you have to reassess those opinions through your own opinion of your own music. Mm-hmm. It's complex. So it is better that you visualize the pedestal, give yourself their images allow the mind to absorb the possibilities. Mm-hmm. Possibilities. They exist doesn't mean that in 2 days you will start playing like that.
Right.
That's out of question. But they are there to show the shining possibilities which has already occurred. It allows you to measure your own level with what is your expectation from yourself. Mm-hmm. And then the journey is a self-assessment journey. A journey of self-assessment is extremely lonely.
Mm-hmm. So your wife and then?
I have my son Budhaditya. Mm-hmm. He has learned also from the age of 5, mm-hmm. plays great sitar. Mm-hmm. But he's a biotechnologist okay. by profession. Mm-hmm. And now he has his own company, the Kamuda.
Okay.
And is doing very well. Mm-hmm. My daughter-in-law, Amrita, mm-hmm. is also a biotechnologist. Mm-hmm. And together, my son and daughter-in-law, they work their company.
Okay.
And just 10 days back, they were blessed with a son.
Oh, how nice. Congratulations.
Thank you. Vikramaditya.
Beautiful name. Wow. Mm-hmm.
And he's yet too small to make some decisions on his life.
Panditji, what will be your message to our younger generation? This is something very important that we really want to hear from you.
Well, I too was young one day. As you might perhaps be young today. So one has to be patient and work with extreme focus and realize if music is your passion at all, then to pursue it with a zeal and zest that will override any other distraction. This is all that I can say.
थैंक यू सो मच पंडित जी फॉर बीइंग हियर. आप अगर हमारे दर्शकों को और हमें आशीर्वाद स्वरूप कुछ सुनाएं तो हमारे लिए तो बहुत बड़ी बात होगी. सो इफ यू कुड प्लीज प्ले समथिंग ऑन द सितार.
जरूर सुनाएंगे.
थैंक यू सो मच. नमस्कार. नमस्कार शोमेन जी. Welcome to our studios. What an honor to be able to accompany Pandit Budhaditya Mukherjee, and you have been doing it for a long time now. So how is your experience with Pandit Budhaditya Mukherjee when he is playing and you are playing on stage or otherwise when you rehearse with him or practice with him?
It's such a great honor for me and such a great privilege for me with Pandit Ji. And last 12 years I am playing with Pandit Ji in India as well as in abroad continuously. And I learned so much things from Pandit Ji.
So Shoman, what gharana do you follow when you are playing tabla, and who are your gurus?
I am following Farukhabad gharana, mm-hmm. and Pandit Ponko Chatterjee and Pandit Arup Chatterjee, mm-hmm. Is my guruji.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for coming to our show and accompanying Pandit Ji.
Thank you.
आपका बहुत 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 धन्यवाद इस आशीर्वाद के लिए हमें. हम बहुत ही भाग्यशाली हैं कि आप हमारे स्टूडियो में आए. आपका बहुत धन्यवाद.
थैंक यू सो मच. थैंक यू सो मच.
और इसी के साथ आज हम समाप्त करते हैं आज की यह कड़ी, सांस्कृतिक सफ़र मानुषी के साथ. अगली बार हम फिर मिलेंगे एक नई हस्ती के साथ. वी आर गोइंग टू सी यू अगेन विद अनदर पर्सनालिटी इन द नेक्स्ट एपिसोड ऑफ कल्चरल जर्नी विद मानुषी. अंटिल देन, नमस्कार.